I thought today, and maybe I'm wrong, but I thought maybe we could kind of talk about guitar philosophy and kind of the way we think about guitars and making guitars. And so let me give you an example, okay? If you have a guitar that, and people can probably relate to this, if you play the guitar, it goes E, 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 E. So if you take your guitar, this is left-handed. The problem with left-handed guitars, I can't even play my own guitars that are left-handed. Can you hear that? They sound similar. This one has less low mid-range in it. Can you hear that? And the pickups pick that up. And the idea is that, and this is a good sentence track. A lot of times it's way worse than that, like way worse than that. And if you have six guitars and you sit down and play them all without an amplifier, you will hear a huge difference in the guitars. And no matter what pickup you put in it or what pedal you buy, and I hope you are putting this on the internet right now, it isn't going to fix it. And has anybody ever had this experience where they sit down and they play five different guitars and they sound different acoustically? Well, it's really, really, really important. And so we recommend, Paul and I do, I think you subscribe to this, to play eight guitars, get the salesman, leave you alone. Sit in the corner and play them and see which one talks to you. If a guitar is only lasting a few seconds when you pluck the string, that's not as good of a guitar as the guitar just keeps ringing and ringing and ringing and ringing. It just isn't. And so we spend a huge amount of time at PRS working on, from private stock or our core guitars or S2s or whatever it is, to get these things to ring for a really long time. You can check how good a guitar is with a stopwatch. I know that sounds bizarre, but if a guitar rings for 10 seconds, it's not as good as a guitar that rings for 45 seconds. And if you were to put a rubber nut and rubber tuning pegs and a rubber bridge on it, you would imagine that the string would last way less time, right? But literally, a really good guitar lasts almost 45 seconds. And you can get a stopwatch out and check it. And it's really important, this acoustic sound thing. And for us, that's a huge deal. We spent an immense amount of time trying to make sure that the acoustic sound of the guitar is good before we put the pickups on it. And we're getting better and better and better at pickups at PRS. But that said, if the guitar doesn't sound good, the pickup is going to pick that up. And if people think that they're going to fix it with a pedal on it, just hold my head in my hands. I mean, has anybody ever really bought a guitar and thought, well, it doesn't sound very good, but I'll fix it with my pedal board? Has anybody ever really thought that?
You thought that.
And that's fair, actually, because your pedal board, you've turned your guitar into a synthesizer controller. You're using your pedal board, it's like a synthesizer, and this is a controller for it, all right? And that I understand. That part I get. But wouldn't it be nice if you turn them all up and it still sounded good? Right. So, I mean, I get it. But I'm sorry, when Hendrix used to turn all the pedals off, it still sounded good, right? We were with this guy last night. We spent 10 minutes talking about the fact that he hears this sound in his head. And this sounds really important in his head. But the idea that he had to take a lesson to get there just was beyond him. Because when you hear Carlos Santana play six different guitars, it sounds like Carlos. If you hear Eric Clapton play six different guitars, it sounds like Eric Clapton. It might have something to do with the way they play the guitar, you know? But that said, I would recommend that. How many guitars do you own?
I've sold loads, I can't remember. I only use two.
Oh, you have two?
No, I have about seven, but I only use two.
Oh, you've got more than I do, so that's cool. So, have you ever sat down and compared them acoustically?
Yeah.
And what was your experience?
Well, one's a baritone and one's not, so it's quite...
What?
But one's a baritone, one's standard, so it's quite difficult to compare.
I'm sure you can find an A note on both guitars.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's okay, fair enough. But come on, what was your experience sitting and playing them? Did they all have a different sound?
Yeah, massively.
Massively.
Yeah.
Okay. But the strings were all made by the same people.
No.
You're really tough. Okay. If you put the same manufacturer strings on all the guitars, would they still sound different?
Yes.
Have you changed these strings in the last 40 years?
Yeah.
You're not 40 years old, so. But am I making sense to you that if they sound wildly different acoustically, they're going to sound wildly different electrically. It's just going to be the way it is, right? And you think a pedal's going to fix it. All right, so let me ask, did the pedal fix it?
No, but they didn't need fixing. They're both pretty good. So they're just very different.
So you're happy with your 7 guitars?
With the 2, the others being sold.
Why are you here?
Well, one of them's a PRS, so you might want to. Yeah.
Is it here with you?
No.
So one of them's a PRS. I got a 7th of this. All right, fair enough. So did he bring one of those things in yet?
Mm-hmm.
All right, so when we get a private stock in here, we'll show it to everybody.
Yeah.
Do you have a private stock?
Jess is grabbing them out.
All right, great.
Yeah, there is one on the wall there, though.
I'm sure. So anyway, from a guitar-making point of view, if one thing's wrong, you've got a problem. Now, that you and I share.
Sure.
Okay. So if the 3rd fret's in the wrong place, guitar's useless. If the nut's not cut right, you got a problem, right? If one of the tuning pegs is slipping, you got a problem. If the guitar is not intonated, you got a problem. If the treble pickup doesn't work, you might get through the gig, but it's not going to be a lot of fun, right? So one problem, and you got yourself a guitar that's very difficult to deal with. And so for us, it's about getting rid of problems, making sure that the tuning is stable, making sure the tuning pegs work right, making sure the nuts don't buzz on the frets, making sure they're not too high, making sure the nuts glued in well, making sure that the neck shape is comfortable in your hand, making sure that the pickups are the right height, that the right sound, that the vine pot doesn't jump on. Has anybody had a guitar where you turn it to vine pot and go bam, bam, bam? Everybody's shaking their head. That's not okay. You got that part. That's a deal breaker. And so what people do, we won't use the vine pot anymore. I use my pedal board and put the vine pot on the floor, and I'll have to buy, an $80 vine pot called vine pedal, right? Do you do that?
Can I plead the 5th?
What? I like you. The fact that you were honest right off the bat is good. You can't fix a problem you don't understand, right? Oh, bless you.
Right. Problem stops coming right up.
Oh, that's great. Coffee.
Nice.
In my house, this is a religion. Do you guys have this religion called coffee?
Yeah.
Oh, God, it's like getting heroin. It's wonderful. I love it. All right, so I'm going to use you as a guinea pig. You come sit here. Come sit down. Come on. I didn't ask you to take your coat off. But you can. So wrap your hand around that neck and tell me if it feels comfortable to you. Yep. Is it easy to play?
Yes.
Have you ever played a real 63 Strat?
No.
All right, so I'm going to tell you. But that's interesting because... For me, I've been going around to these vintage guitar shows, also going to these and holding these old guitars. And I was at a clinic once like this, and I was talking about these old guitars, and this guy says to me, he says, Paul, I said, what? He says, we've never played a 63 Strat. We've never played a 59 Les Paul. We think they're reissues. We don't even know what you're talking about. And I was at Chicago Music Exchange, and they were hanging on the wall behind me. And I said, they're right on the wall behind me. You can try them. I said to the owner, they can try them, right? He goes, no. So that's what an old one feels like. It's got this wonderful thing that's just easy to play. Does this feel like any of the next of the 7 guitars you own?
Somewhat close to my Jazz Master, but not quite.
Is it an old one or a new one?
New one. Classic player.
Okay. Look, he's being honest, right? Fix a problem you don't understand, and telling the truth is a really important thing to me. So the neck on your PRS, do you like it?
Yeah.
But that's not close to it.
No, nothing like it.
Okay. All right. So let me ask a question, and it's a weird question, but does anybody have a question about this? I mean, this entire thing about making guitars, from our point of view, is a subtractive thing. If you have one thing wrong, it subtracts from the guitar. If you're two things wrong, it subtracts from the guitar. If you put a better bridge on the guitar, it's not that it was a better bridge, it's it subtracted less from the tone, right? And it's really easy to understand when, if I told you a lot of guitars in stores are made out of the same thing you hook your toilet to your septic tank with, does that make any sense?
Shouldn't be.
It shouldn't be, right. But it looks like bones. Everybody says it's fine, but it's really PVC plastic. And it's soft. It just doesn't have the same sound. I mean, if you exaggerate it and you say, okay, we put rubber tuning pegs and rubber nut and rubber bridge on, it's easy to understand. But this idea that there are variations in that, it's not well understood. John Mayer has an extraordinary, he's got a building bigger than this entire shop full of nothing but old amps and old guitars that he's bought. And I didn't understand really his understanding of what was going on until I walked into that collection room and I went, oh no. And the ceiling was five times as high as this, and it was nothing but old gear. He had a guy there who was in charge of just cataloging it. That was his full-time job. And when he's got that knowledge base, for him to come out with a model for us is a big deal. Carlos Santana's got one hell of a guitar collection. And for him to come out with a model for us is a big deal. You know, for Mark Tremonti's got an amp collection, and he's used that amp on the whole last record. He didn't just put his name on it for the money. He wanted something he was going to use, right? So that's really important stuff. So does anybody have a question? I know. Yeah, you have a question.
Were you...
that was really fast. Good job.
Were you worried when John Mayer first came to you with the idea of having a similar looking guitar?
That's not what happened. He needed a guitar for the Grateful Dead tour. He needed a guitar for the Dead & Company tour. And he called our customer service people and said, I'm John Mayer, I want to talk to Paul. The guy didn't believe him, almost hung up on him. And he literally texted a picture back with a piece of paper, said, really, it's me. And they got him on the phone with us, and he needed a tool to do that job, to get that Jerry Garcia tone. And so he ended up playing everything we made. He ended up trying every single pickup that we made and started to decide which pickup he wanted in which position. And for that job, the Garcia tone is a middle pickup. Which is pretty unusual. You don't see people use middle pickups very much, but that was that thing, and I didn't understand. But we got the nod to make that Super Eagle guitar, and then we got the nod to make his amp, and then we started to work on this other thing. And so now I'm to your question, which is, was I scared? What was it? What's my emotional reaction? Is that what you're asking?
Yeah. Be a bit more like worried.
No, I saw it as good guitar making. If we came out with a violin that looked like Stradivarius, nobody would have a problem with it. So I saw it as good guitar making. The one thing that got me was that when I wrapped my hand around the neck and we finally tooled it up, I went, oh God, that feels like an old neck. You've never played a real old 63, have you? You're well here.
It's quite chunky on the size of it, but like the,
yeah, but it's rounded over really well.
Yeah.
It's easy to play.
Exactly. Yeah, it's like it's got a nice thickness, but like a balance between.
Yeah, that's the idea. Yeah. Well, there you go.
So no, I was looking at it as guitar making. I looked at it as this is one of the fundamental sounds of our industry, and you know, could we do a good job with it? We had a few conversations. I mean, there were probably 12 or 13 different headstock designs that we went through. There were probably 12 or 13 different pickup prototypes that we went through. We went through a lot of things. Redraws of the way the knobs were. It was part after part after part after
color.
Part.
Color.
Huh?
Color.
The colors. He wanted the scoop to be seen from a distance, so he had us spray a lighter color in here than's here, so it would show up. And we just went through that and through that and through that for a long time. Yeah. And what's a pain in the ass in the beginning becomes normal once you get used to it. I mean, to have to spray this a different color to the sprayers was like, you got to be kidding me. I really, really have to do that? But it was John Mayer asking, so we need to shut up. I saw it as good guitar making. I like those old guitars. Leo Fender used to come by my booth and pay his respects when I first started. They were always looking after the new guitar makers and who was going to have an impact on the industry. And now I'm 62, I go do it, right? But at the time, I was 32 years old, I guess, and I had dreams that I wanted to, you know, make guitars. And we make a 594. We make that. We make privacy. Is there a private stock here finally? Did you bring one in?
No.
We make a lot of guitars. What's in that case?
SE. That one basically. Yeah.
Okay. Well, it's in the middle. If you grew up driving a car one way and you don't like the way the knobs are placed on another guitar, and you probably want it the way you learned how to drive, I think that's okay. I think that's fine. So no, I wasn't frightened. There was one conversation we had that we went at a lot. We went at the headstock thing a lot, and we went at about how we were going to design that jack plate. But the rest of it was pretty easy in terms of getting him happy, but listening very clearly to what he wanted to do, what we wanted to do, and working together.
Was there a point where John Mayer would just pick that up and was just like, no, it's not right here? He wasn't pleased yet.
I wouldn't put it that way, but there were 100 of times that he wanted it to be worked on and changed.
Yeah.
But that's the same with Carlos Santana, if we're working on a guitar, or Mark Tremonti. There must have been 50 changes to that amplifier, and he's finally happy. Was he not pleased? That's not the way it works. I mean, if you're an endorser and you're working with us, you're not pleased with the way Paul's doing things. You're saying, look, can it be a little different? I see the logo could be a little different. Can it be a different color red? It's working together. It's not that way.
The first time when he got his Fender, he wasn't so pleased and he stuck it in the trick.
Well, I don't know anything about that story. That's beautiful. So here's a guitar that Paul's team made. I mean, this is a stunning guitar. Let me be Vanna. Do you guys know who Vanna White is in this country? You don't know who Vanna White is.
Wheel of Fortune.
Wheel of Fortune here. I'll share this to everybody. You can do it.
Yes.
And synthetic opal inlays.
Like this, it really gets colorful.
I taught you, you have to buy it. No, I didn't have a bad emotional reaction. I thought that there was meat on the table left in terms of getting the pickups to sound right and getting the bridges to sound right and getting the neck shape to feel right. Almost all the reviews online, if people got their hands on them, have loved them. There's one review online where the guy picks up his favorite 66 guitar, and he's stunned at how much quieter it is in terms of volume than the other one. He was like, have you seen this thing from Premier Guitar? Oh, yeah, like he was like, oh, wait, let me just compare it to my favorite. And he plugs it in and plays. Oh my God, it's a lot quieter. It's a wonderful moment for me. I said one of the knives slid out of my back, out of the knife block. Look, I see this guitar making. You know, why is it okay for all the other companies to do, but not us? But the other thing was that we had a DC3, and a DC3 was very similar, very, very, very similar. And there are collector's items now on the internet. And we got permission to record Machine Gun from Experience Hendrix, the Hendrix Foundation. And I used a DC3 on it, and it sounded lovely. So, as you would say, as you guys would say. So he had a question right off the bat. See, and then it generated some, yeah. So, yeah, yeah, yeah.
And with regards to the process of designing it, how big is the factor of, or how important is the factor of, like, the copyright thing? So you can't, I know, like, if you... you can't copy a strap straight up. Is that another? So if John goes, oh, can we make it more like this? Are you having to go, that's dangerous territory?
There was a lawsuit in America, and the other guitar companies won the rights to continue making the body shape. So the body shape and that whole side of that guitar is free reign. It's right. Now public domain. Right. The headstock shape and the name is not. Okay. So this has our headstock shape on it, our logo on the front, our birds, our scoop in the lower horn.
So really it's not a huge factor to the process of making it.
Well, of course it is. If I was violating the law, I wouldn't do it.
No, but I'm saying if the shape's up for grabs, then you haven't got too much to worry about.
Not from a legal point of view, yeah. But from a reputation point of view, if we had done a poor job, we got a shot.
No, yeah, of course. But, yeah.
I mean, if the guitar didn't sound beautiful when you plugged it in, we'd just... we've fried at the stake. It's not going to be a good thing. So, but no, from a legal point of view, it was open season.
It's quite nice that didn't have to be a factor in you making the sound you wanted and the look you wanted.
Look, the subject you're bringing up was discussed a lot. There's been no... I've never seen more interest in a new model in 20 years on the internet, ever.
I'm a founder. It's beautiful. I think it's amazing.
Yeah, I think it is. It's really great looking. It's the first time I've seen one.
But you
I think
it's play
a,
it?
No, I don't know. But I think it's a really good one. I don't want to look at it. But it does look sensational, really. And when I saw it online, I thought that was a really nice contemporary one that we're all referring to. But I thought it was a great job. I think you've done a great job.
Thank you. We didn't trace anything, but I did... No, exactly. We even changed the string spacing on the brought it in a little bit because the strings on some of these old guitars hang off the sides of the neck. But these pickups will fit in another pickguard. What's interesting is other people's pickups won't fit in our pickguard. But that's a dirty little trick. Yeah. Well, somebody else had a question over here too. Yeah, go on.
I've got loads of your guitars, and I really like the tremolo version. The tremolo is the best in the world. Why did you not put the same on that?
We did.
It's exactly the same as a normal. It looks slightly different, though.
Well,
look, not so many close.
It's got steel saddles, and it's got a steel plate, and it's got a steel block, because in order to get the sound, I had to change the metal. All right? We didn't encase the thing all the way around. We put little tracks in there for the screws so that it didn't move. All right.
But otherwise, it's the same spec.
But we put our arm with the split thing in there, and we put our screws in the front that are the knife edge. It's essentially our modifications of an old design. There were lots of things we changed so that the block would touch the plate really well to keep the plating down to make the bottom of the block flat. There were lots and lots of things we did to try to tweak it so it sounds better. So I'll give you it's essentially our bridge tweaks to an old design, okay? Would you take a set of these saddles and put it on your 1945 Martin? Why not?
Wouldn't be a Martin and a Kitchy guitar.
Okay, it wouldn't be a Martin and you would devalue the guitar, but maybe it would not sound as good too. Okay, but you'll put them on your favorite old guitar mean, it doesn't make any sense, really. You know on an acoustic guitar, the guitar will sound worse, but you'll put them on your favorite electric guitar. This was invented so that it was adjustable this way and adjustable in height. That's why it was invented. Otherwise, you'd be putting a bone saddle on these electric guitars. It's really hard to get this stuff to sound good. You have to have the thread and the screw and the thread in the bridge to be very, very tight together. You have to make sure that the bottom of the screw is touching really well on the bottom of the bridge to make sure all the knife edges are touching, to make sure that there's very little plating on it. I mean, do you really want to send all the sound through metal scotch tape? That's what plating is. It's like, it'll peel off like scotch tape. Do you really want to do that?
In respect to that, Paul, what do you think of Graphtex saddles? I've used those on some guitar, different approach altogether, but...
They work really well, and it's not my preference on tone. My experience on tone is that a metal saddle sounds better, but that's just me. We've experimented with so many different kinds of nut materials, and the two that we like are the stuff we use, which is a plastic full of bronze powder and bone. Those are the ones I seem to like very, very much. If I thought that material was a better material, I would have suggested it for the main guitars. Is that a tremolo guitar you have?
Yep.
I would have suggested it for this guitar that Paul made, and I would have suggested it for the nut material. The nut material that we use is not the same as Graphtex. This is literally 45% bronze powder and glass powder mixed with a bearing plastic. It's really heavy, and it works really well. So everybody's got a different formula for their pasta. We have our own, and it seems to work. So you're asking me to evaluate somebody else's art form, and I'd rather not do that. But they're made well and they work. It's just not my preference in terms of the tone. But these are subtle differences that all add up. You know, you're talking about just the saddle. Everything else touching the string is a big deal too. So, did somebody else have a question?
You mentioned the DC3 earlier.
Yeah.
Got like
oh, God, what a nice guitar. I want to make them again.
I was going to say, are we going to see them come back? Given
I hope so. It would do much better now. Have you ever heard of DC3?
No,
they're wonderful sounding guitars. They sound wonderful. I mean, we got Guitar of the Year from all the magazines across the whole world for the NF3. Couldn't give them away. And John Mayer put an NF3 pickup in the middle position of his Super Eagle. And Jimmy Herring's playing NF3s. Have you heard this guy Jimmy Herring play?
Oh,
he's amazing. There's a guitar player in America named Jimmy Herring. It's Warren Haynes, Derek Trucks, and Jimmy Herring. They're like a trio. And he plays in a band called Widespread Panic. Whoa. You go to a concert, it's like old Ritchie Blackmore days, where you would go and then he would start to play a solo, and 5 minutes later you were just taken on a journey. This guy's extraordinary, and he's playing an NF3. And I said, why do you play an NF3, Jimmy? He says, because it'll do things my old guitars won't do, which I thought was a really good answer. And I'd like to see the NF3 pickups live again. I mean, we put them on McCarty's, and we put them on private stocks, and John Mayer comes along and goes, I like this pickup. And Jimmy Herring says, I like this pickup. Now everybody's going to get interested again, right? So, yeah, I would love to see DC3s come again.
Yeah. Well, where do you see your business heading in the next 5 years, given the state of the guitar market?
The guitar market's healthy.
Is it?
I don't see this place going out of business. This idea that you're gonna get rid of the guitar market and rock music is dying is just, they've been trying to eulogize, is that a word they use here in England?
Yeah.
They've been trying to eulogize the guitar market for a long time. Rock and roll's dead. What bullshit. The Washington Post did an article on the death of the electric guitar, and that day that it came out, 20,000 people drove from D.C. to Virginia to watch John Mayer play solos, and then another 20,000 people showed up at Sweetwater for Gear Fest. Like 40,000 people show up because they're interested in hearing guitar and buying guitars. On the day it comes out, it was just nuts. And we told him that the guitar sales are back to the old 2008 levels, and they just didn't want to hear it. He had decided what the conclusion was before it ever happened, and this just all hit the internet, and I just said it. I just don't buy it. I don't buy the conclusion. I don't buy it, I don't buy it, I don't buy it. And, you know, in our country, we have these things called chronicles, which is a newspaper that tracks history. You've got the New York Times and the Chicago Tribune and the LA Times and the Washington Post, and there are certain ones. I mean, do you have newspapers here that track history?
Yeah, some. Yeah. The sort of diffusion brands.
Yeah, but so for us, for that article to be in one that's tracking history, and it's my hometown paper, I didn't like it because it wasn't true. Not that I subscribe to Trump's fake news thing, which I don't. The other thing I found fascinating is the day before the election, the day before the Trump-Clinton election, the BBC's take on what was going on was different than America. And I was over here. Well, we were in Germany or something. I don't remember. I wasn't home. And I was watching the BBC, and their take on the news of what was going on was different than America. And I learned something that day, because I kind of liked what the BBC was saying better than what we were saying. And it was everybody had all these things they could say, but what had been selected by the BBC to say would seem more accurate to me. Which I found fascinating for an American, you know.
Outside of America, is the UK your best territory for sales?
It's close. It's a war between the UK and Japan.
Oh, okay.
Look, the UK is a guitar country.
Yeah, it is.
Sorry. Benelux is a guitar area. Germany sells a lot of guitars. There's a love for guitars in Japan, but there's also a lot of guitars sold in Italy. And the home of the guitar, sorry, if you really want it, is Spain. So, you know, there's a lot. There are cities in our country that sell a lot of guitars. Dallas, Texas is a big guitar town. There are cities that don't sell that many guitars. Actually, Washington, D.C. is a big guitar area. Atlanta sold a lot of guitars for a long, long period of time. There's a history of that Southern music, you know, the Allman Brothers and all that stuff that's going on down there. So I like the UK. There's a real love for guitars in this country, big love. And there was, at one point, it was Fender Gibson, Fender Gibson, Fender Gibson, Fender Gibson, and we went to a trade show once and people were saying Fender Gibson PRS, and that happened first in England before it happened in America. You guys accepted this brand long before there was a complete acceptance of it in America. But I can tell you, the English roadies, in the beginning, they wouldn't even talk to me. They'd show me a Martin Birch guitar and turn that out. But there was an Englishman that walked me in and showed guitars to Gary Moore, and we were off to the races. I mean, you know, there are a lot of the artists in this country have been very, very accepting of guitars. So, I mean, one of the very first guitar demonstrators in this country with PRS was Paul Stacey, who did piles of stuff musically in this country. So you're asking a good question. People don't ask very much, but the UK is a very good market for us. I come here. Is Jez here? Our rep is here in the building. His name is Jez, and he travels all over the country, and I call this the rented mule tour, because he's just brutal to make sure that I go visit all the stores that support PRS in this country, and it's an honor to do. My wife understands it, that the English market is almost like family for us, and it's a big deal. And so I say, I'm leaving for England for a week. She goes, okay. You have a question about my wife? No. Look, anybody asks the questions in Target. I've had so many bad things happen in my life in terms of people passing away, that if I can make a joke, I just go for it. And the first time I came to this country, he said, an American with a sense of humor, how'd that happen? Anyway, so does that answer your question?
Yes, sir, it does. Yeah, right.
You both had a question, so yeah. You start and then him.
So when you mentioned, and this is the initial perception from PRS Guitars, that it sits between the Fender and the Les Paul, kind of between, and that's kind of what attracted me as well to get one. But then there's been some movement then towards the Les Paul, and then more movements now towards Strat. How do you see kind of that change of your initial philosophy when you or was that the initial intention when you built the first custom 85, I guess, to kind of be a bit different or be in the middle? Right. And then
you had a genius in this country named John Lennon, right? And he said, life's what happens to you after you make plans. I didn't see this as the road. I didn't think that John Mayer was going to show up and want a guitar for the Grateful Dead. That was a private stock, curly maple top, curly maple back, wildly amounts of electronics, and then he was going to go here. I didn't know what was going to happen. But look, what's the goal? The goal is that you have a guitar that you're sitting on the couch with, you're happy, and you put it away, and you're in no pain while you play it. When you put it away, there's no hangover. It's the best heroin ever invented. I mean, we're drug dealers. I mean, I'm sorry, that guitar is pure drugs, right? So to me, if I've made you happy and you're playing the guitar or something that you really enjoy, or you can use it at the gig, or you can use it at a session or whatever, then I've done my job. So that part I've got grounded and clear. The part about, you know, well, you did your guitars and then you did the 594, now you're doing the Silver Sky. What are you thinking, your Smith? This what you kind of saying, right?
Not
that
issue.
That's pretty close.
It's a change in philosophy, I guess, when you initially started.
I see this guitar making. I mean, if you were Stevie Ray Vaughan and you wanted me to make you a better one than what you had, would I do it?
Yeah.
I wouldn't even think about it. I'd do it. So, I mean, look, when we released this guitar, John posted a picture of it. He was getting 1,000 likes a minute. We got 10,000 in a day. He was getting them by the minute. I mean, he's very polarizing, if you haven't noticed. And he's an extremely good guitar player. And he used to be thought of as a singer-songwriter. When he joined the Dead Company, he converted over. Now he's being viewed as a guitar player, which our industry needs, right? So, I don't see it as a problem. I pick up that guitar. I would use it for tracks if there was a session going on. It sounds good for tracks. It would sit right in the mix, right where you want, like a good reverb sits in the mix. I'm not bothered by it. A lot of people on the internet in their underwear are bothered by it. At CNN, they call it keyboard courage. Where they're sitting there, you know, saying what they think without, you know, any impact. But most of the people haven't played them yet. And this is the first one that's hit the store, right? I mean, it's the first time you've touched one. Did you like it enough that you would give money for it?
Yeah, definitely. It's the only strap I would like. Sorry, not
did you want to play it? No, I can't say that. You can erase that. So if you want to play the guitar, but no, I'm not bothered by it. I just see it as good guitar making.
Has the feedback surprised you?
No. What I thought there was going to be more feedback from the guitar companies. It came more from the punters, as you guys call it. No, we knew it was going to be very polarizing. We knew it was going to be deeply polarizing. What was the saying we had, Paul? When it comes out, everybody's hold on to your seat, something like that?
Mm-hmm.
It was something like, here, when we do this, everybody hold on. Look, there are three stages to anything new. Have you ever heard this before?
Yeah, go on.
It's a military thing. Stage one, everybody's venomously opposed to it. Stage two, everybody's pretty much against it. And stage three, it's the accepted norm. I'm right in the beginning of stage one. But that's the way it goes. You think PRS was accepted? People walked into our booth and said, what do we need another guitar for? They're charging over $1,000. Shut up. I mean, that's how it started. And then somebody goes, no, now wait a minute. Maybe we need to pay attention to this. That's how it started. You think it was all, I mean, I couldn't even get a meeting. I mean, I'll give you another example. One of the feedbacks is a 7 1/4 inch radius is good for chords, but no good for solos. Have you seen this piece of feedback?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Machine Gun sounds pretty good to me. Dire Straits, the Sultans of Swing, the solo sounds pretty good to me. I guess it's no good for solos. What about the John Mayer stuff? What about the Jerry Vaughan stuff? It just doesn't make any sense. Hendrix was playing a 7 1/4 inch radius. Can't play a solo on that, can you? I just, really? Really? The problem with 7 1/4 inch radius is if the frets on the neck aren't dead level, you do have a problem. But if they're level, they're wonderful. Did I answer your question?
Yeah.
What's your question?
So my one's about
Is this his third question?
This is about the controversy, kind of two, about the controversy around it. Have you noticed if it's more controversial in some countries? And also, do you think it's actually in many ways helped the guitar kind of sell quickly and be really, really popular?
I would say it's been most controversial amongst the punters. What do you guys call them? The punters, right? In America, I think it's probably been the most, right? The reason it's being so controversial is people are really interested. I mean, they wouldn't be spending all this time in it if it wasn't really interesting somehow. I had a rock star write me a note and said that I just farted in a spacesuit. And my comment was, I like the way the guitar sounds. You know what he said? Really? And then I got a thing from David Grissom, and he goes, this guitar sounds really good, Paul. Oh my God, this guy's a good guitar player. You know, he didn't come from the guitar playing world. It's not like he grew up in Dallas, Texas, you know, doing that kind of thing, right? But he's a very, very good guitar player. So no, I think people are interested. Look how many people are here. And what are we talking about? We should be talking about private stocks. We shouldn't be talking about that. And we've got the head of private stock here. It's very polarizing. And, you know, eventually people are going to want Silver Sky private stocks. And yeah, that's been an interesting argument. I've had people demand left-handed ones of these before I ship the right-handed ones. That's not going to happen.
Yeah.
Can I just ask a question? Have you ever tried with the tone blocks on any of your other guitars, like titanium and tungsten and things like that, to give it a different sound?
The answer is yes. Yeah. We've played with aluminum, we've played with brass, we've played with steel. I didn't do the titanium and tungsten thing, but we've played with other materials and it makes a difference. Mm-hmm. With this, I was going for, look, if you buy 50 of these old guitars, they all sound different, but one of them's magic. I was trying to make all of them magic.
Right.
And so I stayed with the formula that I knew worked. I could have spent years and years and years on that, and I didn't. And I have played with it. That guitar has a brass block,
right,
and that guitar has a steel block. And they tend to work. I got to play Brownie, the Steve Ray Vaughan guitar.
Yep.
It was a mighty Mike Bridge, all brass. It was not a steel. That guitar, famous for that sound, didn't have that bridge on it. So it had a mighty Mike neck on it, a mighty Mike bridge and a Warmoth neck. It was a parts guitar. It wasn't made by the F company, right? So, I get to call it the G company and the F company. Hey, come on, me. I don't know. We played with a lot of things, but the reason we did that was in order for me to get that sound, that was the best way for me to go. Mm-hmm. And somebody else had a question?
Yeah.
So I've got two questions. One is that when
you... that's the beginning of a bad joke, right? Have you heard the joke? The first answer is A, and the second answer is 2.
Yeah.
Go on.
So when you build this guy, so have you bear in mind that some other factors affecting the tone, like John's pedals or John's the amp John's used? And the second question was from...
John uses a PRS amp. I don't understand. And online, when he did the video, it was a Fender Deluxe. So for me to duplicate his pedal board, I didn't even go there. This was all plugged straight in stuff.
So, and the second question from Ricardo said,
this is B.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. If you will see a PRS Teddy custom. That's from...
Seriously, you are doing Facebook Live and somebody just asked that question?
Yes.
Am I required to answer it? Somebody else have a different question? I'm not answering that. Yeah.
These old heritage myth guitars, like the 59 Les Paul or 64.
You ever played one?
Yeah, both actually.
And did you like them?
Well, my question would be, I did, but where does the myth end and them actually being fantastic guitars begin? I mean, when you picked up, say, John's 60 Steve Strat, makes it so different from any Fender they make today? What is it? What is the magic?
It's a combination of a pile of things. But my experience has been, when you play that guitar and it sounds just like Gravity, because that's what he played it on. Look, I'll tell a story, all right? If you ever hear this thing about why Stradivarius violins sound good? The reason Stradivarius violins sound good is because of the finish. The reason is because it used to be the wood soaked in salt water. They used to make paddles out of it, right? You hear all these stories. Right now it's the fungus, right? And you cured everything with sheep's urine, so they found uric acid in the wood, which is normal. That's how they did it, right? In Italy, everything was tanned in sheep's urine, right? So, but the thing they leave out is that the reason they sound good is because the old man knew what he was doing. That's the one they leave out, all right? Same thing, it's the same thing with the fungus. As if there was more fungus in his shop than the other 20 shops in town in Cremona, Italy. Give me a break. All right, so the fungus makes the wood lighter and more resonant in some way. I'll buy that. I'll buy that the age of the wood has a real impact on it. But nobody ever says because the old man knew what he was doing. Now, I got my hand on some Stradivari violins at the Smithsonian Institution, and they all sounded different, but they had one very interesting quality about them. The harder you hit them, the louder they got, and they just kept getting louder and louder and louder. They didn't have a compressor on them. Which is why these guys like them, guys that would be female and male of these solo violinists, because if they barely play it, the person in the last corner of the auditorium can hear them what they're doing. When they play pianissimo, it's really quiet, they can hear everything, and they love that it projects so well. It's a conversion device between force and sound. My experience is what was going on in these factories in America in the 50s, in the early 60s, is they knew what they were doing. I mean, you interviewed Ted McCarty, he knew so much, it was stunning. And the idea that it's, you know, it's just the age of guitar, I don't buy. My experience is, if you pick up one of those old ones and you pick up a new one, they're not the same. And what we're in the middle of is we didn't have a 50s guitar. That is the 50s guitar right there. That is our guitar. This is our peak. Everything peaks at some time. Neve consoles, according to most people, either peaked with a 5068 or a 50, I can't remember the exact model. I'll remember it in a minute. It doesn't really matter. The ones that were sloped and then the later ones were the ones that everybody thought were the best ones they ever made. And there's a day in which people think those were the best Neve consoles that were ever made. And I saw Rupert Neve interviewed. He says, you guys are going on and on about the sound of these consoles. That's not what the deal was. The deal was that if you were at the BBC and you lost a channel, you got fired because all of a sudden the microphone wasn't live anymore. And I wanted to make sure nobody got fired. I was trying to make sure that they were built like a tank so that they would never break, which was very interesting to me. So when I hold those old guitars, these people knew what they were doing. And to me, I look at it from a guitar-making point of view, and you're trying to look at it from, like, was the guitar better as it got older, or what's the real mystique here? When Hendrix played The Wind Cries Mary, that was pretty much a brand-new guitar and a brand-new amp. And it sounds gorgeous. It's debatably one of the best vintage guitars of all time, and they're brand-new. But everybody thinks it's because it's old, but it's not. I think those guitars sound like that when they were shipped. So I just... my experience of the world playing all these old guitars is that these guys knew what they were doing. They absolutely knew what they were doing. And somebody imitating something it's not the same as the person that invented it. It's always different. But, I mean, you didn't have some sort of reverence experience playing those old guitars?
Not the 60 Strat. 59 Les Paul was pretty special.
Yeah. Well, then I guess you just agreed with why we made the Silver Sky. If I interpret what you just did, because I played some 62 strats that were magic. And so you get 50 of them and they're all different. And I wanted to do the same thing over and over and over again. Everybody will admit, if you get 10 McCarty guitars from us, they sound this close to each other. Our window is very narrow. I'm always trying to move the window up. So that doesn't sound wrong. But maybe it wasn't set up well. What was wrong with it?
Just, it didn't explain it to me. It wasn't bad. It just...
Maybe it was the 30,000 quid that didn't speak to me. Look, I've played some really good 62s and some okay 62s. That's normal. That's normal. But the old Gibson you loved, right? Listen, I was down on, what's the street here in West End?
Denmark Street.
What?
Denmark Street.
Yeah. There was one there, it was a fake. I was like, I picked it up, they said, and they handed it to me, and they were telling me it was an old guitar, and it was a really good fake, but it was a fake. I was like, wow.
And he thought that was an original, did he?
I was told it was.
Wow.
I think he knew it was.
Because I've been doing this my whole life. That's not fair. How did I know? I'll tell you a story.
Did you tell the shop?
No, of course not. No, look. Okay, maybe I'm wrong, but I don't think so. I've had my hands on so many of these old guitars. A guy walked into a vintage guitar show. I told you this story, Paul. And it said 1957 Strat, $14,000 on a little piece of paper on his chest. And I said, don't move. And I put my hand around the neck and I went, oh my God, it's a real one. It's a widow's guitar. It's never been touched. And I said, where'd you get it? He says, I'm selling it for a friend's wife who passed away. And I went, oh, don't move. It's sold. Don't move. Took him in the booth, and I said, that guitar's worth $20,000 wholesale, $32,000 retail. You're not charging enough for the guitar. And I said, I'll get you the money that you want, that she deserves. And he said, okay. So we made a deal. And then what's interesting is the dealer that was going to buy it took it apart to make sure that it was all original. And I went off. I said, the screws have never been out of that guitar. It's never been apart. What are you doing? He says, well, I had to check. I said, I wanted to come across the table and kill him, right? But you got to remember, for us, Paul's the one putting the screws in for the first time. It's not like we're taking these guitars apart and it was made back in the 50s. This is a brand new guitar. And that's a tougher war. Have you ever played one of these private stocks? Come sit down and enjoy a guitar for a minute. So look, if it doesn't speak to you, it doesn't speak to you. And that's fair.
Oh, your guitar speaks to you.
It's the 63 Strat, isn't it? But I think it's kept under a radiator or something.
Take a seat. I'm warning you, you have a credit card, you got a problem coming.
You can play, I like that. You know the vibrato in a sense?
So it's a one piece? It's not a fretboard?
No, that's a fretboard.
Oh, wow.
Really? It's got a nice glue joint on it? Thank you very much. Yes, you have a question.
You said about how when we were talking about old guitars, you don't have that. And these are like your 59 Les Paul, but we're seeing,
well, I don't, look,
seeing like the 85 custom 24s and stuff starting to creep up in price.
They're going up in price really fast.
How do you
they're
sort of
considered vintage guitars now?
How do you see that? How does that affect your private stock sales and stuff? Being as how they're starting to compete price wise, they're in the same ballpark.
He's got 9-10 months worth of orders right now. We're not having a problem. Look, how many people on your crew, Paul?
16.
He's got 16 of the most hand-picked people out of the factory over a long period of time making these guitars, and you're making
50
how
a
many
month.
A day?
50 a month.
50 a month. So, our story is going to be different than everybody else. Everybody has a different story, and when we die, we are our stories. I hope when I die, they're not talking about guitars, they're talking about me being a husband, me being a father, me being a friend, me being this, me being that. But, you know, somebody's going to bring the guitar thing up, and I'm going to come out of the ghost and come kill them. But this is what we do for a living. Paul's got an art degree, and he didn't know how his art degree was going to translate into guitar making, but he's changing the whole color palette of our whole industry on a monthly basis, and there are copies everywhere. What do you call this color, Paul?
That's it's a Northern Lights Dragon's Breath.
And so that's a stained color. That's not a sprayed color. They actually did that by hand with rags. I mean, that's new for our industry, and he's able to take his art degree and figure out how to do this stuff, which is really cool. We used to have a year free reign, year and a half of a color. One of the companies that was either listed G or F literally had a copy of the color in their catalog this year and used the same name. What name was it, Paul?
Dragon's Breath.
It was Dragon's Breath. They literally stole the name. There, yeah. I should have trademarked it. Who brought the trademark story up? I should have trademarked it.
This is amazing.
Not bad, right? For a brand new guitar, it doesn't suck.
Understatement. It's beautiful.
I have a chain around my neck, almost like you were. Very simple.
Okay, guy.
Mine's my grandmother's wedding.
What's this one?
That was half a dog tag. The other half fell off.
Half a dog tag that fell off. Yeah. This is if you give me a drug, I die. It's a warning. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
So, does anybody last question?
Yeah, we talk about wood and stocks and sightings. What's your concerns about the future?
All right, so let me give an overview to everybody here, okay? There was first of all, the wood supplies that we have are really good, and the forests in America are in better condition than they've been in 100 years, which is good.
Definitely don't
want to
leave my wallet over
anymore. Oh. I was going to try to get your credit card out of you before the end of the day. There was a problem with the Chinese manufacturer buying up all the Vietnamese rosewood. It's not something the guitar industry uses. But because it was all getting bought up too fast, and they had made inroads to fix it, CITES decided to make all rosewood restricted. CITES 2, which is normal. CITES 2 is when a mahogany log is cut and it's brought in the United States, you need paperwork for it. That's fine, the whole log. But now they wanted export documents, a new document for every single guitar that got shipped out, done. Not just the in, but the out. And they did it because they didn't think that the inspectors could tell the difference between the woods. Now, it turns out there are other woods that you can't tell the difference between either. And it's gotten really complicated. We have a very good relationship with them. We literally, these people that we'd heard about existed, were in my office within days of them making this new regulation, because all of a sudden the American Fish and Wildlife was strapped with doing thousands and thousands and thousands of permits that they didn't have the staff to do. But everybody's struggled and gotten up to speed with it, and all the stuff that's here has got CITES documentation with the rosewood fretboard. There are woods like Zeracote that don't need it, but are just as good for instrument making. I like to play the game the way the game's played, and that's part of the way the game's being played right now. I'm not that worried about it. The curly maple supplies for us are plentiful. The rosewood supplies for us are plentiful. Ebony, it's fine. It's not really a problem. Bob Taylor's gotten very involved in buying ebony from Cameroon. He knows what he's doing. He went and bought a plant there, and he wanted to make sure that logs weren't rotting on the floor, because a lot of the ebony that comes out, it's not pure black, and they were only taking the pure black, and we agreed that we would use the striped stuff, which is fine. I don't hear a sound difference. Bob Taylor doesn't hear a sound difference. I think what he's doing is man up. It's good stuff. So look, we're not having trouble getting enough wood for these guitars. The amount of orders we've gotten for that, I've got to buy more alder than I thought, and there might be a timing problem, but we're going to have trouble getting this stuff. The wood buyers work directly for me, and Paul and I work directly together, and I think you would say that getting good enough timbers, as they call it in this country, for private stock has been going pretty well.
Oh, yeah.
So I'm not that worried about it, but you have to look. The definition of an expert is somebody in a very, very complicated area that solves very complicated problems over and over again. That is the definition. And by that definition, I've got experts buying for me. So, and I've got experts using this stuff. So, it's okay. I think it's okay.
Of all the guitars you've ever made and your company's ever made, do you have a model or a singular one that you're the most proud of?
I would say that guitar that I made for Carlos Santana that started the company didn't hurt.
Is that a Salmon one?
No, that's much later. You're young. He's known for that Salmon guitar now.
Yeah.
And Paul made that Salmon guitar with his team. We've made, 15 or 20 of them since, something like that.
Yeah, it's a popular color now.
It's a popular color now. So the guitars that have a huge amount of impact on my company, I mean, I have a thing called a Paul's guitar, which is the worst name for a guitar in the history of the guitar business. But that said, they sound good, and I like it. I brought one with me to bring to this clinic, and it got literally taken from me and sold before I got here. But that's, I can make another one. The guy that bought it couldn't. So you had a question?
Of all the guys you're listening to, guitarists you love, who would be the next few people or guy who you want to get the phone call from to build a guitar? Who've not, in the same way John contacted you, who would you be like, oh man, I love this player, it'd be great if you got in touch, we built a guitar for them?
Who? Hmm. Who should say somebody said something?
Eric.
Eric Clapton? I met him once.
Where'd that go?
He was watching Benny Hill. I left him alone.
It's a true story.
He was, Derek Trucks was playing his band. I was making amps for Derek, and I got introduced to him. Jeff Beck? Yeah. I mean, as Eric Clapton said one time when he was on the Arm Stories, the best one we got. Have you ever seen him play recently?
Yeah.
It's not good. It's frightening.
But yeah. No one liked it.
I got a chance to see him play backstage. Yeah, just hold on a minute. I got a chance to see him backstage, and I thought that watching him play would just be astounding how good a guitar player he was. That's not what got me. In 45 seconds, he went from blues to Broadway to Jeff Beck to something else, back to Jeff Beck, back to Broadway, back to blues, as he went up and down the neck. And I was stunned by his encyclopedia of knowledge of music. I mean, he literally was going from blues playing and then Broadway chords, and then, I mean, it was extraordinary what I saw. And I was like, I knew he was good. I knew he was extraordinary. But when he plays a song live, he stays in the same genre the whole tune.
Yeah.
But when he's in the back practicing, that's a different thing. And there was a woman played with him. This is the guitar player. She had told me what he does backstage is way beyond what he does on the stage. And I got a chance to see it because I was making basses for Rhonda Smith, and he signed a guitar for our charity, which was very sweet. An extraordinary musician. My God. Robert Plant's supposed to have that kind of extraordinary background in old blues and knowing the genre and all the different vocals and all that stuff. He's supposed to just be ridiculous. But, the encyclopedia of knowledge in some of these guys is just unbelievable. Carl Santana knows how to play almost everything. And you just wouldn't know that. I mean, Paul McCartney's supposed to be able to sing every single Motown song and sound just like him.
You can hear him, yeah.
It's nice to be in a band of geniuses. That'd be cool. All right, so you had a question.
Yeah, like, is that guitar meant to be a modern take on, let's say, a Strat or something like that? Like Telecaster.
Did you just get here?
No.
Huh?
No.
Then we'll be talking about this for an hour and a half. You want to play the guitar?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, sit down. Come sit down. So anyway, yes.
I read a really interesting article on Reverb and Temple Party. It's fascinating, amazing interview. My question about him, what inspired you to go and look him up and work with him? How did that affect you personally?
He was a king. He invented a whole half of our electric guitar business. Why would I not want to go talk to him?
How did it affect you personally?
Well, he ended up being the grandfather I never had, because I didn't know my grandfather on my father's side, and I didn't talk a lot with her grandfather on my mother's side, and we talked. And I knew I had all the stories when he started repeating himself. Did the Reverb say anything about his relationship with my company?
I talked about you looking up and working on it. I didn't really go into any detail about it.
Yeah, he spent, 15 trade shows with us, something like that, folks? So does it suck? Is it okay? What do you think?
It was really, really nice to spot. Like, it's almost like quite a big neck, but then like it's really fast at some time. Like.
You can play. I like that. When I see young people that can play, it makes my heart warm. You know.
Second question then. Gibson. Anything you want to say about Gibson? The state of Gibson today?
No. Don't believe everything you read. We have no idea what's really going on. It's all predictions. I don't know what the condition of the books are. I don't know what's going on there. It's not going to be the same as people are predicting. It's going to somehow be different. I don't know. And what, you know, I'm not the CFO. I don't know whether the debt's going to be refinanced, which it usually is. I mean, you hear these things about other companies, and the debt always gets refinanced. I have no idea what's going to happen, and I think it's everybody's talking about what's going to happen. It's scaring a lot of people. I'm not sure that's a good idea, but there's a lot of Gibson guitars in this shop, and there's a lot of them in the back. And if you want one, you can have them. And don't believe everything on the internet. Fake news is something I don't really buy. But in that case, you can't. They're saying. We suspect, we think, and that's fair. I don't know. Who knows? And as far as the finances in my company, I'm not going to talk about it. We even hold it back.
You've asked a lot of questions.
How long have you talked?
Did I say yes again?
It was implied. The SE-277 plate, got rave reviews, your baritone. Is there kind of, are you looking at bringing that into maybe one of the American lines, a point of baritone?
I can't tell you that. If I tell you, I tell you before I've told Jez. Jez, have I told you anything about the 277 become a core guitar?
No. I'll make you one in private.
Tell him now what our plans are.
I'll make him one.
Okay, all right, there you go. He'll make you a private stock one right now. Done. And you get the prototype. Go.